I've been here since about last June. A little bit about my history and where I come from. I spent the last 6 years on the Texas-Mexico border as the director of the USDA Cattle Fever Tick Eradication Program. It's a lot of words to say fever ticks. We had 9 offices that spanned about 500 miles, but 120 employees. Fortunately, you don't have a fever tick issue up here, but a lot of places do, and it's a very huge issue for the United States cattle supply. So the last 6 weeks down there, or last 6 years, I'm sorry. So moving up here in the winter, I'm glad it's been a mild winter. I'm used to about 65 degrees right now, so I'm not complaining about your winter at all. Before that, I practiced in Western Kansas for about 13 years and was also with USDA there for another 10 years. So I've been around feedlots most of my life, and it's nice to get here and back in the snow areas of the world. It's just my history. This is very informal, and if you have any questions, speak up. I'm just going over a few things that are occurring at the moment. Fortunately, and I hesitate to say this out loud, we don't have any major disease issues at the moment, exactly. Now tomorrow that could all change, but at the moment we're doing well. So the first thing I want to talk a little bit about is animal disease traceability. And as some of you are aware, a few years ago, USDA started implementing RFID tags, the high frequency and the low frequency RFID tags. There was a ruling put out at that time that gave us dates as far as when they were going to stop doing metal tags and start using RFID tags. That ruling is on hold as far as the RFID tags are concerned. Whenever we have a change in administration, the new administration, as many of you know, wants to go through all of the rules that are out there. And until they go through that ruling and assess it, everything is on hold. So we don't have any timeline for deadlines at the moment. The main reason that we have ADT, or animal disease traceability, is things like this. This is the Rio Grande. And these are cattle that cross every day on their own over time. That's one of the reasons. Another reason is disease traceability. Whenever we have a pandemic, like we are right now, as you've heard about on the news, animal diseases are not that dissimilar than human diseases. Whenever we have a disease outbreak in one state, it travels quickly to another. So we want to be able to identify those cattle, those livestock that are moving. That's the main purpose of it. And for issues like this. So a few more items about that. Official ID is what it's called, official USDA approved identification. And as many of you are aware, we have the RFID tags, which these tags are RFID tags, but they're also panel tags. They're bangle tags. We have the round button tags, but they're all high frequency tags or low frequency tags. They're all scannable type tags, much, much easier for us. USDA is still using the metal tags, the orange capco tags or the silver bright tags. For the rest of this year, we don't know about next year, but for the rest of this year, for all of your replacement females, we will give you RFID tags. If you want them, let us know. The government is giving them to you to encourage their use in the cattle populations. So if you want them, all you have to do is let the Wyoming Livestock Board know, and we'll get you those tags. But we are focusing on replacement females for your operations. So there are no costs to you at this moment. We don't know how long that will last. We know it's through this government fiscal year. Beyond that, we'll see what the new administration says. The former administration was very supportive of RFID tags. I'm just waiting to see what guidance Vilsack takes this year, so we'll see. We also know it's hard. We know we have herds like this, and we know that tagging these herds is not the easiest thing in the world to do. But we're here to help you guys. So if you know anybody that wants to use RFID tags or has issues on official identification, just call us. We're here to help you, to try to make it easier for you. And official identification applies to all species, not just cattle. But in cattle, cattle that move interstate must have a certificate of veterinary inspection. And if they're over 18 months of age, they must have ID. Also, any cattle that are in the show circuits, rodeo cattle, anything like that has to have official ID. And dairy cattle of any age must have official ID. And the main thing is when it changes an owner, it needs to have a tag. We have a lot of questions about sheep and goat ID, especially the earless goats. You can put in microchips, but there are stipulations on that. You can also use tags on collars for your list of visitors. When it comes to the microchips, they have to have a registration tattoo, they have to be in a registry, there are things that go along with it. But there are alternatives to putting tags in those animals that don't have ears. So just call us about that. That's one of the issues that we deal with at State Fair and a lot of the major shows. And here's what it looks like for the earless goats. You can put a tag on a collar, but that collar cannot be taken off and it must accommodate growth. If we see one that's too tight, that's an issue. But you can't do that. Does anybody in here raise sheep or goats? Anybody? Wow, amazing. Okay. Anybody in here have rabbits? Because that's going to be up for discussion too. I was hoping somebody would say yes on the rabbits. So on the sheep or goats, there are specific rules, which get really confusing, about who has to be ID'd. But once again, anytime anything changes ownership, it has to be ID'd. But I won't go on about this because we don't have any sheep or goat books. So rabbits. So you may have heard that we have what's called rabbit harassment disease in the state of Wyoming right now. What is this? Why does it pertain to me? Why is it a big deal? This disease moves fairly slowly. It started about 2 years ago along the southern border, New Mexico, Arizona, coming out of Mexico. And it's finally made its way to Wyoming in the last couple months. Why is it a big deal? Because it affects both domestic and wild rabbits. So when you start looking at the food chain of our wild rabbits, if we eradicate that food chain, rabbit population, we have some serious issues. Right now, we have it in Wyoming in our wild rabbit population. Currently in Albany and Laramie counties. We went from, this is a one positive up to almost 8 now in the last couple months. And it's difficult to control because it's just sudden death. That's all you see is sudden death in rabbits. You might see a bloody nose, you might see a rabbit kind of off feed for a little bit, but basically it's just sudden death. And if you know folks that have domestic rabbits, the main thing that we can do is biosecurity. And I'll talk a little bit more about that. So how do we keep it out of our rabbits? We actually have a lot more meat rabbits than you might think in our state. We've been talking around the state now and been surveying. You guys are one of the few, usually about out of every 5 people, somebody will have a meat rabbit, which is really surprising. We'll pull that number except we had some class. But we found that in our audiences. And then they just have a couple meat rabbits, but they're pretty popular. On the wild rabbits that have the RHDV, if your domestic rabbits are not basically, if closed off on wild rabbits, your domestic rabbits are just dying shortly. I hate to say that, but they don't handle it well at all. So biosecurity is the number one prevention for this. Can you guys still hear me? Or maybe years from now. And all we can do is make sure that our domestic rabbits are not exposed to our wild rabbits. Make sure that you have a change of clothing. Don't go from outside to inside to your rabbits. Don't go visit other rabbits and come back to yours without changing your clothes. Don't invite people in to see your rabbits or visit your rabbits or hold your rabbits unless they put on the same clothing and shoes. Don't mix your shoes from the outside to the inside. If you have people that have rabbits inside, you cannot wear those same shoes in and out. You are the primary transmitter of RHDV. It's us. So we have to be extremely careful. As far as vaccines for RHDV, there are only two vaccines currently available. They're both in Europe. We do have a clinic that's going to import some of the vaccine. They will be sharing that vaccine with other veterinarians. But it's not cheap. It's usually 2 doses initially, then 1 dose is being given thereafter. Price can range anywhere from about $40 a dose to up to $80 a dose. Maybe more. It's kind of expensive for a rabbit. But if you're raising meat rabbits, and that's something that's important to your family, but there is not a vaccine approved in the United States for this issue for RHDV. Keeping in mind, we didn't have this strain until 2018. So it is affecting our wild rabbits and the mommy rate so far. That's the point of view. Also, if you see any dead wild rabbits, please notify Cape Fish. Let them know or call us. Let them know there's many examples on a regular basis all across the state. You can go go to the Wyoming Game and Fish website, and they keep their map updated, usually daily, of where the samples are coming from and where the positives are at. And I was hoping to show it to you, but the connection is just not going to work. But they do have an updated map where you can see what counties are under surveillance and how it's moving. Another thing that we've noticed, obviously, was diagnosed in December. So what does that tell you? This virus is extremely resistant to temperature. Our weather does not prevent it at all. And it moved up from Mexico during the summer. So you can see that hot or cold doesn't make a difference. So we really don't have a way to stop it from moving. Biosecurity is ours, and we prevent it from infecting our rabbits, our domestic rabbits. So if you know anybody with rabbits, tell them to call us. And we hope it doesn't affect our wild population to the point that we see food chain issues. And it does affect both jackrabbits and hares. Anybody see many rabbits around here or in your areas? Keep an eye out for them because we need to really monitor this disease. And then brucellosis. A few little things going on right now, nothing major actually. We only have, and I was just saying to see this once again, but we only have two premises currently under quarantine in Wyoming for brucellosis. And they're all, actually, I'm sorry, we just released them. We have one now. And they're both on the way out of quarantine. So it's been a pretty quiet fall, winter for brucellosis this year. And that mainly is because you guys are doing surveillance. You're letting us leave your cattle. You and your cattle vaccinations. You're doing the things that we ask you to do. So we say thank you. And of course, you guys all know more than I do that our biggest issue with brucellosis in most cases is that wildlife interface. We're kind of in a drought right now. Would everybody agree with that? So is our grazing pattern going to change for the elk? It is. We're going to start seeing some differences if we don't get some moisture, as far as where they're grazing. When you have that wildlife livestock interface is when you see a brucellosis issue. And what time of the year is it primarily spread? Calving season. So when you have that livestock wildlife interface during calving season, we see increase in brucellosis in our herds. That's when we have to keep them apart. You guys pretty much all know that it causes abortion, but it also causes just chronic weakness in calves, stillbirths, cows that don't milk well, arthritis, and you also probably know that it affects people as well when you go milk. Many of us up there have titers. So what are we doing also in the state? Surveillance. Everything that comes out of the designated surveillance area, which is pretty much everything in the Yellowstone area, we require all calves to be calf vaccinated less than 1 to 12 months of age. You have to be calf vaccinated, and we ask that you do adult vaccination in those high risk herds. Something that will be happening very shortly, actually in about a week, is that Dr. Brad DeGroat, who is the other assistant state veterinarian, and I will be going into the DSA area to try to get folks to do herd plans. Does anybody in here have a herd plan? What we do is we do a risk assessment of your premises to determine what your livestock's risk is of getting brucellosis and transmitting. Once we determine that, we can sometimes waive the movement requirements or some of the other requirements if you're a low risk. Excuse me. We'll also help you pay for those surveillance tests whenever you do move, though, if they are required. But it depends on the risk of your birth. So we're going into all the herds that are in the DSA, or people that graze in the DSA, to do a risk assessment of those herds, try to help them ease some of the requirements, try to help pay them for some of the things that we do, and keep our surveillance high. We'll be starting that process of really pushing those herd plans in about another week or so. So it doesn't cost you anything, it actually helps you out. Any questions on that from anybody?
Are they still checking the slaughter cows at the plants? Yes.
Was there.
Right, exactly.
So I know I heard one time that the COVID, they kind of quit or something, and one of the plants did or something.
They do, and we have issues in Idaho right now with that because they don't have enough employees. And there's only one plant in my lane I know of, small local plant that was having some issues as well currently. Because they didn't have enough employees to get the samples collected and get everything done. Yeah, but that is required, and that's one of our primary methods of surveillance. Exactly. And if you hear any issues with that, please let us know. That's a big issue for us.
So if you're not in a designated area, you don't need to do the line, or you do?
If you have cattle that are near the DSA, we still encourage it. Yes. Now, if you're on the other side of the state,
no.
If you primarily, everything you have is on the eastern side of the state,
no.
We're right here, but I mean, you know.
We encourage it. Yep.
You would?
Yep, absolutely. Yes. Any other questions about this? The risk assessment probably takes maybe an hour and a half to go through. And then we analyze all the answers, put everything together, look at where the elk movement is, where the bison movement is, put it all together, determine your overall herd risk, and go from there. And I do apologize if you guys noticed, most of these are not Wyoming calves. They're a little farther south. Like way farther south. So the thing I'll bring up that we didn't have last year, that we expect this year, is vesicular stomatitis virus. Has anybody had it in their horses?
Could I ask one question before
yes, sir.
We move on to this?
Yeah.
Are you working with the Game and Fish with the elk feedlot program?
Absolutely.
What's the state veterinary's position on that?
I can't tell you that. I honestly don't have to be here. Yes. We are working with Game and Fish, and we're also doing a lot of risk assessments to determine what's the best. There is no easy answer for that, as you all are aware. Well, did you get on some of the calls they had? And
yeah.
Them? Good. And give your opinion or your thoughts on that. Excellent. We're looking at CWD, brucellosis, all those things put together. And what is the correct answer, which we don't know yet. Our primary thing is to avoid that livestock wildlife interface. Whatever we can do to make that not happen is our
goal. Shut down the feedlots,
that's but we're just that easy. That's the only problem, as you know. But then we have CWD that comes in too, and the feedlots promote CWD. So there's lots of issues besides that. I'm glad you were on those calls. Hopefully, in the next several months, we'll be going over that some more and putting all that together. Vesicular stomatitis, has anybody in here had to deal with it? Sorry. Star horses? Everybody healed over here? Well, we didn't have it last year. I don't know why. We didn't. We fully expect to have it every year, so we'll see what happens from this spring and summer. Many of you have seen it. Vesicles. I'll be going to go over vesicles. Vesicles, blisters. So clinical signs, we have blisters, we have slobbering, we have a frothy mouth. We can have blisters around the coronary veins, blisters in the tongue, blisters in the ears, rusty ears. And what species, you guys know what species we get those? Basically any cloven hoof or horses or elves. Okay, just about any livestock species, we get vesicular stomatitis. The problem that we have with vesicular stomatitis is that it also looks like which, as you guys know, was a huge issue that we don't want in the United States. So what do we look for? For those that have had it in your animals, you can see that. You look for an animal with a frothy mouth who is slobbering profusely that wants to eat but can't. They have huge blisters on their tongue, and those blisters will basically pop, and they'll slough the skin on their tongue. Extremely uncomfortable. If you've ever had a blister in your mouth, you know what that feels like. And their gums, and then also it will affect their ears, their eyes, their hooves. And sometimes all you may see are the ears. That's it. When I came up from Texas, it was about last June-ish when I moved up from Texas. It had hit in the border towns in Texas. We had several premises that had BS. But they only had in the cattle, well, I was gonna say that. We had primarily cattle, which is horses and all they had were teeth lesions. That's it.
nothing oral, nothing in their ears, and on their feet, just their teeth. And the only reason we even found it is because our job is to scratch for ticks. And where do you look for ticks? Looking for parasites. We notice it on our teeth, that's it. So you don't have to have it in every different area on the animal. And it changes every year, is what we've seen. We don't have a treatment for it, we don't have a cure for it. Once we have it in a county now, we don't record the rest of the cases because we know it's already there. So be looking for this, be on the lookout for it. If you've had it, you know what it looks like, let us know. And all you do is treat the symptoms. And then you also do biosecurity because you don't want it to spread on your place or to your neighbor's place. You guys remember how it spread? What spreads VS? Typically it's flies or us. So these lesions could be foot and mouth disease, they could be vesicular stomatitis. So you see coronary band lesions, you see hoof sloughing, you see teat lesions, you see nasal, anything with blisters, and those are your capsules to foot, mouth, and then test, and it's hopefully not an associated or something. Any questions about it?
Yeah, it isn't exactly the same thing. Okay, because I heard it was the same.